Sweet. Hey guys, how are you? Great. So I just want to check whether I'm in the right place. How many of you are here because you want to make a lot more money by show of hands? Like nice and high. So that's like 20% of you. Okay, cool. And how many of you are here because you don't only just want to make money, but you actually want to make a lot more impact with your life by show of hands? In fact, say I. Fantastic. Okay, cool. So I want to share with you, and I figure that if you are here today at Fuckup Nights, number one, you're not afraid of swearing, and that's great because I swear quite a bit. The second thing is this, is that you're probably an entrepreneur, maybe a change maker, a social change agent, maybe you call yourself something else, a hacker or an innovator, or maybe you're aspiring to be one. And you're trying to figure out how to grow fast. You're trying to figure out how to bring your gift, your mission to the world in a bigger way, in a faster way, without all the painful risk and all that. So what I wanted to do today is to really be able to just download to you guys to the tune of about $1 million worth of lessons in terms of what I've invested, in terms of what I've lost, in terms of the revenue that we've made, and the big fuck-ups that I've had along the way. Right, because I think some of these things, I like to feel, I like to believe that my pain has a purpose. And hopefully, for one or two of you at least who walk out today, you learn something from that, and then you would make it all worthwhile for me. Okay, so, but before I do that, you'll probably want to understand a bit, because you have this strange guy who's standing in front of you who has like a Muslim name, looks a bit Chinese, wearing this colorful shirt, and you just have no idea who this guy is. So is it okay if I share a bit more about myself? Yeah. So my name is Imran Mohamed. I'm a founder of a company called Street Smart University. In the last year, I've launched an Amazon best-selling book. I've spoken in 6 countries, including Germany, Thailand, Australia, Malaysia. And I have the absolute privilege of doing something that I love. I ask myself this, what do I do every day until the day I die and be happy doing? Every single day. And I realize my one thing is to sit down with business owners and discuss strategy to give them the light bulb, to give them the clarity and focus and momentum to move forward faster. And so, all I've done with my life and my business is structure everything around that. So you might have seen me in some of the news features that we've been having. For example, I've been featured in Tech in Asia, in Sunday Times, in 938 Live, just to name a few. But besides that, I'm also a father. I'm also a husband. You might also see that in a past life, I was about 12 kilograms, a bit heavier than what I am today as well. You would see our friend Fazil in the background, our junior partner Mark in the who's over there, that's on a beach in Bali. So I have a great privilege of living a life, at least for me. I can only speak for myself, of meaning, of purpose, of being able to travel around and doing what I love. Right? But I want to let you know that it was not always this way, because if you just saw me 3 years ago on Christmas night, so this is December 25th, 2013. You would have seen me like this. I was in the boardroom of one of the newest, tallest office buildings in Kuala Lumpur. In fact, you probably see the Twin Towers behind. Yeah. And this was Christmas evening. And I was in this boardroom alone, wearing my t-shirts and my berms, and I was working on a 100-page government proposal. And I was there alone. The aircon was off. I was overweight. I was burning myself out every day because I was rushing this thing alone all the way until New Year in Kuala Lumpur, in a foreign place alone, sacrificing my time, my health, my family. And the worst part was after that week, we actually didn't get the proposal. So we didn't get we didn't even get the deal. And I spent all that time and all that money. And do you remember what Fazil, my business partner, said earlier about us getting into debt? This was at that point when we were in partnership, we were consultants, we were going around doing government deals, but we were freaking broke. I was freaking broke, and I was going to get married in 6 months. We were $50,000 plus in debt, and I had no income, and I was like, oh my God, what do I do? What did I do with my life? And I got to tell you this, the big fuck up is this, because I tried to do all the right things. You know, like, Faz didn't go to school, right? He did, he just didn't get a certificate, okay? So I'm corrected, but I actually tried to do all the right things. So I went to the good schools. I went to National University of Singapore. I went to the business school. I took an entrepreneurship minor. I went to Silicon Valley. I worked in startups. You know, what did they tell you about starting a business in the scene? You put together a nice little deck. you do a proposal. And at that point, I had failed 6 times in business already. In fact, for 8 years, I was struggling and I was insisting upon trying to figure this whole business thing out, because I had this moment in national service when I was serving military, when all my individuality and all my haircut and all my name was stripped from me, and I was just a number and a rank and a uniform staring into the jungle, and a new version of Singh is available. Is this important? And I was staring into the jungle, and I realized that I needed to do something with my life. And at that point in military, I had no choice, but I knew that I wanted to make a choice. And then I decided, I had this brilliant idea, I'm going to be a business owner. And that led to me failing 6 times in business. I remember one morning going down to the basement or to the kitchen of my family home, and my dad asked me that morning, Imran, why don't you get a job? Why don't you get a real job, Imran? Why don't you stop all this fiddling around and get a job? And he proceeded to ask me that question every day for the next 1 year. So I kind of fucked up then, because I did all the right things. My parents had really, really high expectations of me. They wanted me to be a scholar, and then I became a 6-time serial entrepreneur who failed. And so that was a big first fuck up. And the second thing was this. So the second big fuck up was this. We finally got around to do it. We finally got this idea that, hey, we were stumbling around doing business and failing and failing and failing. And every time I fail, I learn, oh, I shouldn't put my money here. I learned that I shouldn't work with this kind of people. Oh, I learned I shouldn't do this thing, right? But we had to do it by trial and error. It was so expensive. It was so painful. I burned so much money. Fazil and I got together and we said, what if someone actually taught these things, like for real? And that's why we call our company Street Smart University. And we were like, oh wow, that's brilliant. What if we made it into an app? I bet everyone would download it. And we actually went out to pitch. Startup Slab was the first place that we pitched. And then we went on and we pitched at Startup Singapore. We were semi-finalists. We pitched at Echelon Asia. We were semi-finalists. We raised seed funding from known angel investors. And then 1 year later, everything fell apart because we burned through everything. We had no customers, and we didn't know where our business model and our income was going to come from. Right? Sounds like a familiar story. Most businesses, even the ones that get funded and get lauded on the news, fail. You know, just ask these guys. They've been around for a while. We've been I was from NUS, so we've been in the incubator for 2 years before we got our office where we are today. And in that incubator, in that little house that we've been housed in for 2 years, we saw maybe about 40 plus companies go through the gates. And today, only us and one other company survive. Right? That's the reality. Right? So for most people, the dream of entrepreneurship ends up becoming a nightmare. And that's what we saw. That's why we really started this. So we successfully pitched for money, but we didn't know what to do with the money. If you don't know how to make money, if I throw you money, you're going to just amplify that problem. These guys are like, yeah, they know it, right? So the last fuck up is this. I don't have the time to tell you this, but we turned the business around, right? So we went from $50,000 in debt. I was super motivated because I was going to get married. I was like super motivated. I was like, I got to do whatever it takes. We started doing everything, knocking on doors and telemarketing and like everything. And then we did like 130K of revenue in 6 months. And then the year after, we tripled the revenue. So we went like that, super fast. But, you know, sometimes we tend to forget why we are doing what we do. So I was like, all hustling. There's this term, right? Today, hustling for my business. And I think I started to forget the real meaning of why I do what I do. And I just want to tell you a story of why I do what I do. And it's a bit personal because it's from my family and my history. And I think every one of us has some sort of baggage that we bring as well. And I remember one day, I witnessed domestic violence at home when I was a kid. And I remember going up to my mom's room, and she was sitting by the window, she was looking out, and she was crying. And then I was a teenager, I had no idea what to do. I felt so helpless, but I knew I had to reach out. And I went up to her, like I was silent, I didn't know what to say. But she turned to me and then she looked at me and she said, "Imran, it's all my fault." And I knew just then, I knew that no matter what it is, hate, violence is not the solution to anything. It doesn't create anything. Nothing beautiful. And I resolved that one day that anything I do would be out of love. Anything that I do would be out of love. And that's why I do what I do. But don't you guys realize that sometimes the thing that we want the most is the thing we push away? And I found myself with the love of my life, the mother of my child. I told her, "You don't get me. You don't get this big entrepreneurship dream. You don't get me." And I pushed her away. We called off a wedding. And I don't know, for the young guys, we tend to think, like, especially with the young guys, when you're running a business, it tends to be very macho, very ego-driven. But you guys have no idea how strong women are. You guys have no idea. No idea. And and she came to me, and she said, "I need you. I'm 100% committed. And no matter what you say, I'm going to be here." And that turned me around. That love from a woman turned me around. And that reconnected me with why I do what I do. But I really almost fucked up. We called off the wedding. Like, we feels really close. We called it back on like 1 month before. It was crazy. Yeah, it was crazy. So thank you. You have to thank my wife. I don't know whether she's around. I think she's putting the baby to sleep. But being able to activate this core of myself, I don't know every one of you, and I don't know why you're here, but I do know this: we don't start a business to feel stress. We don't start a business to manipulate. We don't start a business to feel constrained. We don't start a business to pretend to be someone who we're not. So why do we keep trying to do that? I decided that I'm not going to be this freaking guy in a suit dancing around in boardrooms for old men. I decided. And that's why I turn up the way I do. And that's what's allowed me to go and travel around the world, hold Tony Robbins' hand, pose with Gary Vaynerchuk, and just amazing stuff. Like, simply because I just refuse to be held by the limits that most people hold themselves by. And I just believe that if you are able to do that for yourself, you live a much, 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 much happier life. Let's not talk about money as well. So this is why I do what I do. And this reconnects me every single time. You know, like, being here in this moment, I know I'm living my purpose to be able to share, to be able to give my message, my passion. But there's this duality. The moment I step out, I'll be like, "So where's my family? Where's my kid?" Right? And that's all my life is. Family, business, family, business, family, business. I think there's very little life-work balance. I think for me, it's just all life. And if I were to leave with you guys, three golden rules today is this. Number one is create the right support. What Fazil mentioned about having the right mentor is super nail on hit. Stop doing things by trial and error. Stop trying to think. Stop trying to believe or fake yourself that you're so arrogant that you can know it all. How is that possible? It's not. Right? And the moment I realized that, and the moment I just sought people for their expertise, we just move so much more. And I stopped pretending to be good at Facebook ads. I stopped pretending to be good at building websites. You know, I stopped pretending to be all these things that I'm not, and I just focus on what I'm really, really good at. And once you have the right mentors, once you have the right advisors, once you have the right team, once you have the right people around you, family support is super, super, super important. Then you create that support, because entrepreneurship and business is freaking chaotic. It's chaos. Every day you're pulled around with 1,001 decisions and 100 fires to fight, right? So you need to have the right support around you. It's crazy to jump into the deep end. People do one of two things. They either stand at the edge and say, oh, wow, look at the pool. It's so beautiful. I wish I could be in it. And then they do nothing. Or they jump into the deep end with no training, with no, maybe a bit of research, with no lifeguard, with no mentors, with no support. And you don't want to be either of them. You want to have the support around you. The second thing is this. Because entrepreneurship is so chaotic, every single day is so chaotic, and you know there's ups and downs, you want to control your focus and your state every single day. So what I do is I wake up early, I set my intention, I do meditation, I do a daily exercise and stuff like that. So these are the things that keep me on point. In fact, it's the only time of the day that I fully control. Because today, when I come here, after I walk out, there's probably a bunch of you that's going to like pull me for attention or questions or just to connect, and I have no control over that. But I know when I wake up, when I have my black coffee with coconut oil and I meditate and I do this and I do that, I can 100% control my state and I walk out feeling like a million bucks. So you need to control your focus and your state daily. Remember why you're doing it. Know exactly where you're going. And the last one is this. And I think some people were asking about fucking up and whether they learned something about it. It is all just newness. If you're afraid of starting out or if you're afraid of failure, just know that it is newness. And we forget that we are this kid that learned how to walk. And we forget that we're this kid that learned how to ride a bike. That once we didn't do it, and now we do. So it's all just newness, but we have this primal instinct to equate it to life-threatening situations, when it's not. It's just business. The worst-case scenario is you go back to your job, and for some of you, you're already in your worst-case scenario. Right? Let's just be real. Right? That's the worst that could happen. Right? So it's just newness. Once you understand that business, just like anything else, is a skill, and you can embrace it, and the faster you embrace it, the faster you learn, the faster you implement, the faster you get feedback, the faster you tweak, because the feedback and the failures are not permanent, neither are they labels of failure, they are just feedback. The more you see it as feedback, and you tweak, 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 that's what happens. You suddenly get a six-figure business, or you suddenly get a $500,000 business, and then you can do that fast. So those are the three golden rules that I have for you. I just wanted to check with you guys, because normally I would either speak for a couple of hours or for a whole weekend. How many of you would actually like me to help you with your business 101? Because this is what I want to do for just a handful of you guys who would like to have a chat with me. Okay, cool. So if that's you, and I like it, there's just a handful of you guys, what you want to do is to connect with me on Facebook. You can find myself on Facebook. Let's have a nice mutually beneficial arrangement where you connect. I'll give you some advice. We'll talk about your business, but also share with me on my Facebook wall, what did you like about my presentation today? It will help me a lot. It will help others a lot as well. Because if you know that you benefited from this, then we know that there are probably tens or hundreds of thousands of people that need to see this more as well. And that's what I live for. And I don't want to be shy about that. And the last thing is we will have that chat. I'll spend about 1 hour with you. And we'll have a chat seriously about your business. So that's it. I love you guys. Thank you for being you. And thank you for being here and spending your time and your life with us. I'd like to open up for questions. It was a bit serendipitous. One thing I did was this. I looked at all the things that weren't working, and I told Fuzz, cut. Toxic people, toxic activities, things that weren't working, things that weren't profitable, cut. But we've invested, cut. cut. So the first thing I did was I became hyper aware of what was costing me all this pain. And then I cut everything from that. So we cut toxic partnerships. We kicked out a CTO that wasn't working, and we gave him lawyer's letters. Like, we just did whatever we needed to do to cut off cleanly. Then the second thing was, we were like, okay, so what the fuck do we do now? Right? But we made an intention to do something different. And you know what? I think serendipitously, someone came to us and they said, hey, you guys been around Street Smart University. I've heard of you guys. You guys seem to be good at online. Can you build an e-commerce site for us? And we were like, no, that's not what we do. And they said, we have $11,000. I said, I'm your guy. I'll do it. I'm your guy. Right? And we started this whole web division. They created websites for companies. And we started with an $11,000 contract when I had no company, no branding, no proposals, nothing. And from the first day, we were profitable. That's how we started. And then I figured that if there was one person in the world with this pain willing to pay for a solution, there would probably be a handful of others. And then I said, hey, Fuzz, Mark, let's grab together a bunch of guys. I have a few people in my team. I just launched out on Facebook. I said, I'm looking for a few good men. And then the guy in the yellow t-shirt, Mark, hey, say hi, Mark. So Mark runs a web agency today, especially around lead generation for businesses. He was the first one that commented. He said, yes. And then I took him and a few bunch of other guys. We literally went to like a place like Arab Street, Katong, and I said, go. And we just knocked on doors for 6 months. That's all I did. I just knocked on doors. I had no sophisticated marketing plan or campaign. I didn't know all the stuff that I know today about branding and media and online marketing. I had no idea. But I knew I was freaking desperate. And I think once you really know what you want and that the result is non-negotiable, you'll go out and do it. So that's how we turned that around. Yeah.
Continue that conversation in a smaller group. Let me just quickly wrap up. Please give Imran.